Hi, everyone. So my talk is Monitoring Complex Systems, as was introduced. Some of you know me. I'm BL Troutwine on Twitter. I'm Troutwine in IRC. And I do things to and with computers. I'm a software engineer. I build real-time systems. So I imagine all of you in this room understand real-time. There's an implicit clock. I tend to work on soft or firm real-time systems. And in Erlang, you just sort of fake it with a firm real-time system and hope you hit the deadlines most of the time. I build fault-tolerant systems, so systems that have to maintain their operation, even in the result of failures of individual components of the system or individual computers in a cluster. And I build critical systems. My particular hobby horse is working on systems that have some sort of disastrous consequence. So the way I sum it up is either humans die or businesses die if the system fails. It ends up being sort of stressful, but it ends up being a sort of very meticulous engineering, which I enjoy very much. My current employer is Adroll, which is an advertising company. It's a retargeting company. It's all online ads. The advertising business has changed a lot in the last 5 years. So if you think about advertising, you think about depictions and media portrayal, people doing art and whatnot. But it's not really that anymore. It's more like this. It's engineers and scientists all sort of getting together to give you ads for things you may or may not want. engineering plus mathematics equal to ads. We all love online advertisement, and you're welcome. I work on real-time bidding. So real-time bidding, you have a web page load up, and you have all those little ads, right? Those don't actually exist when the page is rendered. When you begin to load the page, there's an auction that begins, and that auction is what real-time bidding is predicated upon. Without that auction, there's no business. The problem domain is really interesting. So it's very low latency, and it's very low latency across the internet. So we have less than 100 milliseconds per transaction, meaning that from the time that we get the notification that there is an auction that's begun, we have 100 milliseconds to get that back to the far side. It's a firm real-time system. So in that 100 milliseconds, if we miss that deadline, it's what's called timing out in the jargon of the problem domain. And that's a real problem. You can't time out. You always have to respond. You either have to respond with some sort of monetary value, or you have to respond with what's called a no bid, just meaning I don't care about this, I don't want it. But you have to respond. And it's highly concurrent. So as of last Wednesday, we did 90 billion transactions in a day. When I gave a similar talk in Erlang Factory, it was 35 billion. So we're just ramping up incredibly. And it's global 24/7 operation. So if you think financial trading, they have similar constraints, but they're able to shut down after about 10 hours. We just keep rolling all around the globe. I build complex systems. So complex systems are really interesting. They have nonlinear feedback into themselves. So one tiny little modification after a couple of weeks and you crash the system. But these are critical complex systems, so you can't crash the system. They're tightly coupled to their external system. So our partners that give us the auctions, for instance, if they start sending us garbage, and they do send us garbage, we have to take that and we have to work with that. There's an interesting example later of tight coupling. And they're difficult to model and understand. The bidder is simple. If you do one bid, say a day, you just say no bid. And then you elaborate that and you say $1. And then you decide, well, I'm going to bid $1 10 million times. Then you've gotten into something interesting at Adroll with data scientists and whatnot, which makes it even more complicated. Complex systems have this interesting behavior that really bad things happen when complex systems fail, because you built one of them to address some problem that was already difficult. So you push the domain of horror far past the post of where it originally was. So Carlos Bueno, who is an engineer at Facebook, has this really great book on optimization, but this particular observation in his book actually applies to understanding any sort of system. So he says that humans are bad at predicting the performance of complex systems. Our ability to create large and complex systems fools us into believing that we're also entitled to understand them. So the difficulty that we have when we make these things is understanding what they actually do, because there's emergent behavior, there's complex feed, or there's nonlinear feedback from operations teams, things like that. So because they often create worse problems than those they solve, our key challenge is really maintaining our understanding of it, of not only thinking, okay, well, great, I've made this thing and I ship it out into the world, but continuing to sustain it while it's out in the world. So what can be done? How can we actually maintain this understanding? So there's ahead of time verification. These are things like type checking, quality assurance. You know, you say, well, I've got something that could be a production system, but before we go through these types of verifications, we'll apply these procedures. And these things are great. Like, don't scrimp on them, seriously. But it's not sufficient for maintaining understanding. And there's compile time guarantees. This especially is like type systems. Testing, in a certain sense. These are great, too. Like, these are absolutely essential. But they're not sufficient. But don't scrimp on them. What we really need to maintain our understanding is insight into the running system, is to be able to interact with the running system. And in particular, when you want to do that for an Erlang deployment, you look for VM killers. So for those of you that don't do Erlang, there's a real fun trick. Go start dynamically creating atoms. You'll find that you can create about 2 million of them before you crash the node. So don't dynamically create atoms in a production system. But that sort of thing, like that's the sort of thing you need insight into, because maybe you have a bug. Maybe you've decided in your hubris that I can create a finite domain of dynamic atoms, but you've got a bug, and so you just keep allocating them. We're looking for application performance regressions. So independent of what the VM is doing, you have your own ideas about what your application should be doing, and each time you make a change to the production system, you've potentially run your ideas aground. We're looking for abnormal application behavior. So for instance, in the real-time bidding system, which is called Buddha, by the way. If I say Buddha, I'm not talking about religion, I'm talking about the production system. Sometimes we no-bid with a price. That makes no sense, but we've done it. So we have to keep track of that because the exchanges get real confused, and they hate being confused. And just surprises in general. You want to have a nice, steady knowledge of something that is dangerous. You want to have a steady knowledge, and you want that knowledge to be realized in reality, where it has a steady behavior. So, instrument everything. You use instrumentation to begin to get an insight into a running system. And Erlang is amazing when you need instrumentation. It is just chock full of all sorts of things that you could possibly want. Not about your application, but about the VM state itself. And these are all baked in as built-in functions. So Erlang memory gives you almost everything you might want to know about the memory allocations of a running system. So I suggest you look at the man page, because it's much too detailed for me to go in here. There's Erlang statistics. So this tells you things about the processes running in the system. So memory gives you a high-level understanding of the system and sort of where it's all allocated. But this particular BIF allows you to inspect individual processes or see facts about groups of processes, which ends up being remarkably useful. And system info is just sort of a scattering of the rest of the information you might care about. It's sort of incredible. Like, Erlang was clearly made by people who were very serious and very concerned about keeping things running, because the amount of tools that you're just sort of given out of just the base install are remarkably useful. Things that you didn't even consider that you might want are actually there waiting for you. You just have to go trolling through the documentation. But what about our own work? What about our own applications? You know, we have those particular set of criteria that we're very concerned about. There is a really fantastic library, and it's called Exometer. So Exometer is something very similar to Folsom or Statsmon. I forget entirely what they are. Exometer is the best, far and away the best. Exometer can be a little tricky to learn, because Exometer has a very sophisticated understanding about what it means to instrument your particular application. So this is not an Exometer tutorial, but they're important terms for when you go to study Exometer. A metric is just sort of something that you would care about. So an example metric would be Erlang memory called with the binary, or with the atom binary. So you're asking Erlang for It's a binary allocation. That is a metric. It is simply a value in time. An entry is a receiver and an aggregator of metrics. So think about a histogram. You start stuffing binary allocation totals into a histogram. You build up this nice histogram. That's an entry. There are counters, there are sliding windows, things like that. A reporter is something that takes one of these entries and ships it out over the network. Or network is not quite true. Generally over the network, because you want your information to leave the system that might fail, right? But you can actually print it out live. That ends up being kind of a mistake to print out live, so disable it. But it's useful in development. We ship out to StatsD, basically, and then that goes to another service. And it's really useful. And a subscription is the period at which a reporter queries one of the entries for values. And the really fantastic thing about this, and which makes Exometer distinct from Folsom, is that these are all loosely coupled. And it's not immediately obvious why you would care about that. So if you're using Folsom in production and you ever think, well, I have this, but I would really like to have two things report its value at different intervals. That ends up being a little trickier than it would be in Exometer, because in Exometer, it's just, okay, well, it's another subscription. You don't even think about that being a difficulty anymore. The other thing that I really like about Exometer is that the configuration is static. So you can see explicitly what it is that you're instrumenting. And it ends up being remarkably useful for communicating about the system, for everyone to have a configuration file that you can reference. I can't think of how many conversations I've had where, oh yeah, this is the name of that, this is the name of that, by just pointing at the configuration file. But Exometer can be dynamically configured on the fly. So if you decide that your production system needs some sort of metric that you haven't put into place yet, log in, put it into place. Super useful. So why Exometer over the alternatives? Like I mentioned, there are things like Folsom and Statsman. Statsman, Statsub, does anyone know what that's called? No one? Okay, well, I looked at all these libraries and I only remember two. So Exometer is extensively documented. Everything you could possibly care to know about Exometer has been discussed in its documentation. Code comments, actual documentation, it's all there. It's also vigorously maintained. So if you happen to have a problem with Exometer, or you happen to have a feature that you would like, contact Upstream. Upstream happens to be Ulf, so this is sort of Ulf fan club day. Very, very good relationship with Upstream. And for me, the thing that I care about very much, because I'm very, very latency focused, is that Exometer is stupid fast. I can push 1 gigabyte per second of instrumentation through Exometer, and Exometer does not delay my application. It is incredible. So it does, there's this really great trick that it does. So reads out of Exometer are slightly slower than, say, Folsom, but writes are much faster, and you end up doing writes most of the time. And this is because Exometer allocates 1 ETS table per entry, so say histogram, per scheduler. So it avoids locks for when you write, and then when it reads, it just goes over all those ETS tables and then combines the values. Kind of cool. Okay, great. So we have instrumentation. So you can kind of get an idea about what your system is doing, but we've got no way of looking at it, right? We've only discussed, okay, well, now we're just flinging it across the network, but that's not enough. So now what? Well, monitoring. We have to monitor these things. This, unfortunately, is the hard part. Like, it ends up being remarkably simple to just sort of instrument everything and go, okay, well, now I'm done. You're actually not done. That was the easy part. Visualization. So monitoring is broken up really into 3 different subtopics, each of which are an entire subfield of computer science. So enjoy that. Visualization. Everyone knows that visualization is hard. You know, how do I visualize a histogram? Well, you think about the bar thing, but say you've got 40 histograms, all of which are interrelated. Not so easy. Alerting. So how do you decide that something has gone wrong? You can have a human sitting there watching graphs. You'll find this in hospitals where people sit in front of cardiac monitors. That's okay because you've got 40 patients. You have slip-ups, but it's sort of okay. But when you have 90 billion things happening, no human can keep up with all of the graphs that keep track of all of that. So you have to have some sort of automated way of deciding things have gone wrong. Generally, things are going wrong. You actually don't want the alarm that says, sorry guys, enjoy working at midnight. Analysis. So being able to take your visualizations and your alerts and turn them into a cogent understanding of the actual running system. That is probably the hardest of the three of these. This is why we have data scientists. This is why we have business intelligence units. This is super hard. Like, this is the hardest one. So visualization tells you how things look, but not why. So you get this chance to sort of use your eyes and say, okay, well, that's great. And you have to gain an intuition about what looks okay without necessarily quantifying it. It works out because we're a very visual species, so we're good at pattern recognition, but you can also sort of fool yourself, right? So an example, this is part of AdRoll's, so like I said, Buddha. Buddha is the real-time bidding system. This is a value, a chart of our spend. So incidentally, if anyone happens to be watching this video in the future, this is a limited section of our spend, so IPO, whatnot. The blue line is the current day spend. The purple line is the last week's spend. So you can see we're actually doing a little better, and it ended up being rather blurry. I'm sorry for that. So that's about midnight over there, and then this is about 3 in the afternoon. So through the day, we're just ramping up our spend. This is a particular region, and we're doing great. This is a really good day. This is a bad day. So again, the top, we're spending the current day, and the bottom line is last week's. Now you might ask, you're spending way more money. Why is that a problem? Because we like steady behavior. Steady behavior is reliable. We had that little gap there that sort of tracked over. That's a steady curve of growth. This is potentially us spending money that we shouldn't be spending money. So that's a real problem, because this could be a dire, dire thing where we have to get billing involved and business intelligence and send a lot of apology cards. So growth is really good, but steady is better. Like, we really, really want steady, reliable behavior. So when we started looking through this, because suddenly it was a, you know, pull the fire alarm, everyone get involved. We started looking at what's going on in the system. We started correlating, doing an analysis from the visualizations. So blue line, again, is current day. Purple is last week. This is a total of the bids from the same time period. Bids are the things that come into the system, the little ad slots that load up. We started looking at them, and we sort of know from our intuition, just based on past behavior, that these are basically the same. So bids are not changed. So we're spending more money, but we're not really getting any more traffic in, which is kind of a concerning thing. It's not really a thing that should happen. And our budgets are stable. So we track the budget that the bidders have. And you see that they're basically flat, right? Like, we're a little up, so that means that we've been given more money by our clients, but we haven't had a jump in budget. So the bidders have this behavior where if you give them a ton more money, they go, well, great, I'll spend it. But in this case, that's not happened. During this time period, budgets have remained flat. So what actually happened here? This is actually kind of a concerning thing. We've looked at all of the bid requests, and those are flat, and we've looked at the budgets, and those are flat. Like, there are no changes here that should indicate that spend would go up. So, you know, we worked this for an hour, four people in the team, we've suddenly decided, you know, we don't know what's going on. We've got to get business intelligence involved. And getting business intelligence involved is kind of one of those, like, well, the reactor's going to blow up. Let's just leave before we all die. It's actually a really terrible thing to do. Like, we don't want to do it. So what actually happened? We eventually figured it out because Jose, who happens to be in the room, suggested a really brilliant thing. We forgot about Labor Day. Holidays are quiet times. So if you compare over the month, it's fine. See, so the yellow line is us tracking over month, and then purple line is Labor Day. It happens that the blue line there is exactly 1 week after Labor Day. No one goes online on Labor Day. You're all out getting drunk and eating hot dogs. So we're not serving you ads. So our spend is low. So if you compare only over week, it looks like we're doing a drastic thing. But in fact, we just have normal behavior. It was the week metric that was the one that was an aberration. But the visualization doesn't tell you that. Visualization doesn't give you enough context. There's no good visualization to say, oh yeah, holiday. We happen to know that it's a holiday after about an hour, but it's not enough to tell us to not be worried. And as we move into more global markets, you know, I don't know Chinese holidays. Eventually we're going to hit a Chinese holiday and freak out, and then it'll just turn out that people aren't online. So alerting tells you that something happened, but not why. Maybe you see a pattern. There's a why here that doesn't keep coming up. Alerting sort of just blurts out that a thing has happened. So this is the number of bid requests that come into the system. And again, unfortunately, that's blurry at the bottom. That's from midnight to about 6. So this is a particular region of the world. And you see that people aren't really browsing the web at 3 in the morning. A lot are, like surprisingly. A lot of people are browsing the web at 3 in the morning. But you see growth ramp up at like 6 in the morning, and then it starts to drop toward the evening. So this is a good, normal day. We see a nice binaural curve because we've got mammals searching the web. Now this is a bad day. Yeah, so that shouldn't happen. Like, this is a pretty drastic problem. So the system's ability to function is entirely dependent on our ability to get bids in. So each bid that comes in, we might decide to spend money, we might not. But if no bid comes in, we can never decide to spend money. So that's a real problem, because that's a steep drop in one of the busiest times of the day. So zooming in a little bit, like, you can see that this is a really, really drastic cliff. There seems to be no particular ramp down. So sometimes when we have an error, like on our end, you see this nice slow curve of death. But this is a hard cliff. So we track our timeouts. Timeouts are the things where we actually go over the deadline, because soft real-time language and a firm real-time domain. So these timeouts look pretty decent. You know, they're less than 1,000 generally. God knows what happened at those peaks. We're investigating that. But the real concern here is at 1445. That happens to correspond exactly with the cliff. It just falls to nothing. And it falls to nothing because there's nothing for us to bid on, so our timeouts don't exist anymore, because this heavily loaded system suddenly has a lot of extra spare capacity. And we track our errors, the number of errors that we emit. And you can see before the crash, you can see the crash about here, right? Before the crash, our error rate is pretty normal. There's nothing to indicate that we've done something wrong to have our partner just sort of, you know, destroy our traffic. So what happened? So again, this is the thing where we worked it. We worked it hard, because this is a drastic problem, right? So we had the whole team, and we were all going, I don't know, you know, business intelligence got thrown around. And then finally, one of the project managers in the other team said, hey guys, you realize that Facebook is down, right? So Facebook.com went down for 45 minutes. Now Facebook.com is exactly the graph that I was showing you. That was the bid request coming in from Facebook. They go offline, they don't have any traffic. They don't have any traffic, we don't have any traffic. But the visualization doesn't tell you that. We've got nothing to alert us when Facebook.com is serving up its, oh, I'm sorry, you know, everyone come back in like 45 minutes. So the visualization doesn't give you the why, and the alerting that we got from PagerDuty actually doesn't say why. It doesn't say, you know, bids tanked, by the way, Facebook is down. Don't have that. So analysis is the last piece, and analysis gives you the why, but only if you know how to ask for the what. Only if you truly understand the system can you figure out what to analyze. So in all of this sort of debugging, you know, that I've been saying, you know, we've been throwing together these visualizations and the alerts and trying to analyze them and turn them into some cogent understanding of the behavior of the system, the emergent and nonlinear horrible behavior of the system. So this is a fun one. So this is the memory use of a bidder over about a week. Yeah, about a week. So you can see that during the peak times of the day, you'll just have to take my word for it because it's rather blurry. During the peak times of the day, we allocate more binary memory, we allocate more memory, and then during the night, we deallocate it because there's less traffic in the system. So the bottom is the same healthy group of bidders. The top is an experimental system. We've implemented a bunch of new features, and then we're watching it in sort of a steady environment. And then over a week, it allocates enough memory, and you see here over on the right-hand side where it drops off, we didn't decide, well, you know, this experiment is done. It killed itself. It just died because it allocated too much memory, and then it got killed by the kernel. That's not good. But this is the total allocation. You can see up there in the top left-hand corner, of all Erlang memory. So we started asking ourselves, where is it that Erlang is allocating memory? And we looked at atom tables, and we looked at the general VM killers. And then we discovered that, in fact, it's exactly correlated to binary allocation, which you can see up there at the top left hand. So the system is allocating a bunch of memory in binaries. So we asked ourselves, where could it be allocating memories? So we looked at processes. And you see here, the blue line is the system that is working fine. The purple line is the system that eventually kills itself. You can see that it runs out over there. Processes aren't allocating these binaries. Okay, great. We have a bunch of ets tables. Surely we're losing ets tables somewhere, or we're cramming too much information in ets tables. Nope. It's not in ets tables either. Again, you can see that it actually tracks really perfectly. So our caching system is behaving just as you would expect. But where else could the memory be? You know, it's not in processes, and it's not in ets tables. Where else can you stuff it? What happened? So this was a problem that took 2 weeks to track down, just like constant working, six engineers. Finally, we figured out that it's a bug in Jiffy. So we do this thing where we encode this massive, massive bit of data into a bit of JSON so that we can push it over into data science because they read JSON. It turns out that you really shouldn't encode things that are multiple megabytes into JSON with Jiffy. We think. So as I left, as I got onto a flight for this conference, this was still being worked. There was a really good understanding of exactly where it occurred in the system, and there was a really good hypothesis for why it occurred, but hypotheses have a tendency to break. So don't go out and start burning Jiffy, printing out, burning it. Shout out to Miriam Pena for working this. She was really the motive force behind figuring this out. And this was a really, really hard problem because that new system has a lot of features that are needed for other sort of business purposes. Really hard work. Like, she worked constantly for 2 weeks. Okay, great. So we have monitoring and instrumentation. So we can start getting instruments, you know, into monitoring. And even though it's sort of difficult to combine these three different subfields of monitoring, you know, you can sort of do it. It's better than not having it, right? So now all of our problems are solved. Not quite. So every new technology creates something, but at the same time, it also destroys something. And you sort of have to be willing to accept the things that it destroys. And it might destroy it because it happens to make something irrelevant, or it might destroy it because it solves a really hard problem, and you've pushed the horrors past the post of where they were, and now you've come into a new world. So instrumentation makes up for our lack of insight. Right? You know, we think we have this complex understanding of this system that we've made, but we really don't. We're biased, flawed humans, and we've only worked on a tiny portion of it. So instrumentation makes up for that, right? And monitoring makes up for our frailty. You know, monitoring allows us to take this giant stream of data and turn it into something that you can sort of look at and be alerted on and feed into data science so they can do their mathematics. But every solution brings its own problems. In particular, instruments may be misleading. Instruments might tell you that a certain thing has occurred, but you've introduced a bug in the instrument. Say, I know at one point when I was hooking up Exometer for the first time, I hooked up Exometer incorrectly to the memory readouts. So it looked like the memory readouts were 10 times higher than they actually were. I got an alert, and then we all freaked out because the boxes are going to die soon. They didn't because they weren't allocating that much memory. But that actually caused a production issue, you know, incidents reports and all of that. Instruments may be overwhelming. You know, I said that we were pushing an incredible amount of information. The last time I counted, and I haven't counted in a long time, the bidders pump out around 600 individual instrument values. I don't know what all of those do. I know the application-specific ones. I know a subset of those, and I happen to have a decent understanding of who to ask for the other large chunk. But I don't know all of those. And then there are all of the ones that get pumped out just sort of automatically. And synthesizing those into an understanding of what the system is doing with my ignorance is a really hard problem. It ends up being a sort of thing where a fault has occurred, and then you have a group sort of coming together to fight their ignorance together by sort of combining these things. instruments may be inaccurate. So it might be that even though you have it all hooked up right, you're not actually measuring the things that you're expecting to measure. So this is the Hubble Space Telescope. So I don't know those of you that know, we shipped it up and it was nearsighted. Just slight, the lens was slightly ground wrong. So then what we did was we sent another mission up with basically a telescope contact lens to put onto the telescope. It was an immensely expensive operation to do, very, very risky. That poor fellow hanging on the end of the arm, if he had fallen off the arm, he would die, right? So when you make these instruments and you decide to make decisions off of them, it's remarkably difficult to get that right. You know, just a micron was wrong there. But you start thinking of instruments as the source of truth, as the ultimate arbiter of what is and is not going on in the system. And that's a really challenging thing to remember, that these might be wrong or delayed or just wholly inaccurate. Instruments might be ignored. So instruments can be ignored either through general laziness, you've hired someone that doesn't really understand or care, or there's just too much information and you just sort of blank out and decide, well, I kind of know what's going on. The backing photograph here is in Chernobyl Reactor Unit 2. I'm sure all of you know what happened in Chernobyl Unit 4. They ignored some instruments that said, whoops, we're in an iodine well, don't do the thing you're going to do, for complex reasons. So what can be done to overcome these faults of monitoring and instrumentation? Which, you know, don't take this as monitoring and instrumentation is a bad thing, because it's a marvelous technology to apply to your system, but it does have its own faults. A little paranoia, never hurt anyone. So when you have this like source of truth coming out of your system, keep in mind that it's not necessarily true, or it's truth with a probability attached to it. That is remarkably useful because let's go back to the binary memory leak. You know, we look at processes and we look at ETS tables, and we could sort of decide in our hubris, well, it's not going anywhere because there are only two places. Ergo, the boxes are just crashing for reasons we don't understand. Ship it. And that could have been a thing that we did, but we didn't do it because we had this understanding that there's a probability assigned to these particular values of truth. You know, you have to build intuition and whatnot to figure out what the probability is, which is the trick of analysis. Use glass displays. So monitoring and instruments ends up being a social activity. You have all of these instruments coming out and people understand them to varying degrees. But then if you have someone whose job it is to build the one true dashboard for understanding the system, you're going to find that they bake in implicitly, without intending to, and being perfectly reasonable about it, their own implicit and biased understanding of the system. So give everyone the capability of building their own dashboards, and I guarantee you, if you do, they'll all look different, and you won't be able to understand any of them except your own. You'll think everybody else is crazy, but they'll be able to get results. Glass displays are amazing. Train. Train up on these things. Simulate disasters, and then go through fixing the disaster. Or diagnosing the disaster, or have people ride along with you while you're looking through these things, interns, what have you. It's very, very useful to practice. Practice makes perfect is sort of a cliche, but it's also true. Keep sight of the main goal. Your system is built to do something. Now, you can sort of decide when you're making all these instruments and monitoring things to monitor things that don't matter. You know, how fast is this particular subcomponent that I built? You might think that's really cool, but it doesn't matter insofar as it doesn't affect the performance of the overall system, even though it was probably pretty fun to write. And I've done that myself. Or like, oh, look at all the instruments for this thing, and nobody cares, because nobody should care. And have resources that you're willing to sacrifice. So, the bitter system at Admiral is intentionally over-provisioned, and it's over-provisioned so that we don't have to care about individual machines. So we might, through our lack of understanding, not be able to diagnose an issue fast enough. And we have boxes die, but because we have extra boxes, it's okay. So we have a lot of red shirts hanging around. We just let them die while we're trying to figure these things out. It gives you breathing space to tackle the three difficult subfields of monitoring in trying to derive an understanding of the system. And as behooved me to come on this trip, if any of this interests you, Admiral is actually hiring. It's really fun. We are in San Francisco. And that's all for me. Thank you, everyone. Questions?
You say to simulate disasters, which is obviously a very good investment of time. But how do you do that? Is that AWS? Like, I know there's Chaos Monkey, which uses AWS to simulate DDoSes. Do you have any other, what other disasters do you simulate, and how do you do it?
Yeah, so it ends up being very dependent. So the question was, how do you simulate disasters? It ends up being very, very dependent on the system. A lot of times what we do to simulate a system that's overloaded, is a new version that's going to be in an overloaded state, is just to ship it into a region that we think the impact and spend won't matter too much, which is kind of a bad solution because it's just like, production! But it's a really great way of deriving a lot of traffic because it's immensely expensive for us to actually generate all of this traffic. Other things that I've seen people do is fake the instrumentation. So you have the monitoring boards, right? And you just feed those monitoring boards false data. And then you have people diagnose what's wrong in the data stream. That ends up cutting out the interaction with the actual machines, but it gives somewhat of an intuition of what looks right and what doesn't look right. Replaying old instrument data during a disaster, so kind of what I did here by doing the debugging, but you can replay it if you collect it, which is the other great thing about Exometer. Each entry can be multiplexed to different sources. Keep that stuff if you can.
You said you ship things to data science for mathematics.
Yeah.
Can you go into what that is?
Yeah, so the decision to spend money is a rather complex one. We don't just say $1, $1. What we do is, retargeting works by collecting information from your travels through the web. So there's an AdRoll pixel, which is a bit of JavaScript, and just sort of says, like, this user was here. And then we derive information from that. That information ends up getting fed to data science, and they build statistical models of how likely you are to care about any given what's called a vertical. So extreme sports gear, photography equipment, things like that. How likely you are to care about those. And then we categorize our customers based on the verticals. So you come to a website. We happen to know that you're 100% likely to click on ski ads, which never happens. So you're 1% likely to click on ski ads, which is immensely high. We look that up. So what data science does is they build these statistical models, and then we turn that into basically a lookup cache, and then we ship that asynchronously to the bidders. And during the bid flow, because we can never go across the network, once the bid flow has occurred, you can't reach across the network. We do one, maybe two network lookups, and that's kind of dicey. But the lookup cache, the data is so big, we can't do that. So we just look that up, check the probability, and then derive a price from that. Other questions? Scratching your neck? Okay.
How often do you find yourself in the situation where what you needed to monitor and look up into a metric is not something you're tracking right now?
In the early days, all the time, and it was terrible. So the question was, how often do you find yourself in a situation where the thing that you needed was not a thing that you were instrumenting? And the answer is all the time. In the early days. By now, we've developed a sufficient understanding of the actual behavior of the system that we have a pretty decent idea of what is necessary. But you'll actually find when we work a long issue, like the binary memory leak, that a lot of boards, a lot of visualization gets made that ends up being totally irrelevant because you're sort of guessing. Like, where's the pattern? Where's the pattern? And that ends up being a real challenge because sometimes you make a release that adds a bunch of instrumentation that you never needed, and then it sort of sits there and keeps emitting. In the early days of the system, we had no sophisticated instrumentation. So what was done was a release would be shipped. And this is before I started. A release would be shipped, and then the bidder would run for a while. And then after 2 days, they would go ask business intelligence, how's the spend look? And if the spend was up, everything was great. That release was good. If the spend was down, oh dear, we should fix something. Where's the bug? What did we change? So as we added instrumentation, right, we got a more sophisticated understanding. We got a more real-time understanding of what was going on in the system.
You collect an awful lot of metrics. What do you use for aggregating and visualizing these, and how much historic data do you keep?
Good question. So the question was, what are we using to aggregate and store the metrics? So we use a product from a company called Datadog, and that's where the graphs are derived from. they keep six or three months of data. And every so often we push so much data that they ask us not to, but then we sort of tap the contract and then they ramp up our cluster. But they've been incredible. Like I highly recommend them. I contributed code to Exometer, so it's remarkably trivial to ship instrumentation to Datadog. A really great company, very quick on feedback and concerns.
Offering some information that you'd like, that you wanted and couldn't quite get from any of their Erlang BIFs?
Yeah, so the operating system information, so the question was, is there any sort of operating system information that we wanted from the BIFs that we couldn't get? We actually don't use things like OSMON or MemSup, things like that. We use instrumentation on board the operating system. So AdRoll has a lot of different systems, and there we have sort of this default thing that ships. And so what you see when you look at the instruments coming out of the bidder system is the bidder specific, the Erlang bidder specific, because we have other Erlang systems, and then the operating system specific. So you sort of combine those, and we combine those with tags. They all say tagged Buddha, so they're all coming from a Buddha node. Oh, do we not have one more? Who wants it more? I've got two here. Okay.
You mentioned situations where something like Labor Day or Facebook going down causes something that you think is a real bug. And normally when you have real bugs, you're like, okay, what did we break? And how do we not do that again? When things like Labor Day happen, do you just sort of say, haha, that was funny. Hopefully this doesn't happen very often. Do you actually have like some advice for trying to prevent stupid things? It was really just some external happening.
Yeah, so the question was, how do you deal with these sort of externalities, these things that just sort of pop up? The answer is we don't laugh at them. They're considered serious things because they take engineer time to work them. But what we actually do is a really good question. So we've started sort of having a what holidays have just occurred, but we don't have anything automated yet. But we're going to have to figure it out as we move more worldwide because, like I said, Chinese holidays just scare the shit out of me because I have no idea what they are. But they're a big thing, right? So we're going to see effects. We saw the World Cup, like effects in traffic. After a goal, traffic would spike. And it was incredible to see, but if we didn't realize that the World Cup was going on, and I'm not a sports fan, so I didn't, they're like, why is traffic spiking? And then I hear people cheering elsewhere in the office, and I figure something happened. I don't have any systematic idea for how to deal with that yet. But I want one, and if you've got an idea, please talk to me, because it's really important. I'm told that that's all the time I have for questions. If anyone else has anything they'd like to ask me, I will be around for a while.